Welcome to another episode of Dr. Kamini Rao's Masterclass.
And I'm talking about 1 month they were giving 700 rupees salary. 10 crore children come under midday meal program.
Spectrum, you are able to sort of feel because you were part of it.
We are able to involve the people in the society. The cost per meal in Adam, for us, for Adamya Chetana, is very less because there's a lot of voluntary involvement. Engineering, it needs more systematic approach. So nothing
goes. That's excellent. Because see, this is something which children should learn, and even our viewers should know that you can really have a zero garbage kitchen. And it's not only about midday meal, but learning about all these things is important. And also another thing, why not solar energy?
Yeah, I'll come to this. Yeah, one is the garbage and showing, demonstrating that not reducing but making it zero. So I always say that yes, I have not given even 1 gram to Bangalore Municipal Corporation since last 10 years. No vehicle, nothing, no one comes. I don't want any municipal corporation people to take our waste, no. Second one is my entire fuel that we use for cooking 50,000-60,000 meals per day is from waste material. Entire fuel comes from waste material, and it is possible. These are called briquettes, B-R-I-Q-U-I-T-T-E-S. And when we started, we used to get these briquettes from Gujarat. Then it was Davangere. Today, even in Bangalore, Tumkur, there are industries where they make these briquettes from the segregated waste. That's what people now segregate the waste at home and give it to municipal corporation. Industries also give it. So using those and adding some more things into it, they make briquettes. So I use briquettes for cooking. That's a fuel which saved almost 50 LPG cylinders per day.
That's 10,000 per year
is, and it's not one time or twice. It is doing it for 12 consecutive years. Not buying even one LPG cylinder, whether you do whatever food you prepare. We changed the preparation style and proved that we can still do it. It is possible. Then briquettes, pellets, and biogas, the food waste, is also a fuel for us. So one is the wastage, then water conservation. These are the messages our children have to carry. Including, then we started talking about how do we reuse the paper. In fact, we conducted workshops for school children. It is not just children. The whole idea is to teach their mothers or teach the people of the society. So I always wanted volunteers to come and learn and teach. We did not hire any trainer or teacher to teach all this. So from the waste paper, we taught them how to make a pencil, pen. We have nice, from paper you can make many things, a pen stand and so many nice usable utility things. From the waste paper. So we do conduct such workshops, even some teaching aids for teachers. And so we first, our volunteers learn, then they teach the children. Both of them learn the value of all these otherwise called waste things. So nothing should go out as a waste material. And one more small thing which became very popular because people keep
bag. That is also a very important thing. Tell us about that small milk bag.
Yes, milk
and
packet.
How you cut it. That was very interesting that you said.
Yeah, so because I'll tell you the story. Last, it's some 6-7 months back, just before the COVID thing, I was traveling to Delhi. And I met one very senior person, retired judge or somebody with a suit and all. He said, "Are you Mrs. Tejaswini?" He said, "Tejaswini Anand Kumar." I thought must be friend of Anand Kumar because who will recognize me in Delhi? And he said, he was not knowing about Anand Kumar. He said, somebody had sent that Facebook message of yours and I am following it since last almost 1 year. And he said, there is a big change in my lifestyle, from my clothing to everything changed. I was taken aback, but then I started talking to him. It was that one Twitter message of mine, which I used to follow at home. Once morning, I thought, what shall I write? And so when we open the milk packet, you know, every day morning, we cut the milk packet and take out the milk. So the small pieces, normally people used to cut the corner. And if you look at Bangalore itself, we have some 50 lakh households. Even if you take one packet per house, it is 30 lakh small pieces. And these small pieces, when they get into the garbage, you cannot recycle them. So when you cannot segregate, you can recycle. Segregating small pieces is difficult. Not only that, there's one now, people have started talking about microplastic. The microplastic is fine plastic dust, which is getting into the soil, getting into the water. In fact, unfortunately, it is coming back to us in the form of salt. Every brand of salt has microplastic in it today. This is IIT Delhi's one research paper talks about it. And the mineral water, the bottled mineral water, what we supposed to be one of the cleanest water, has again has 1 liter. The study of UN Environment Department says 1 liter on an average has 220 microplastic particles.
That's a lot.
And so how it's happening? It's because of the smaller pieces of plastic. It's because of our lifestyle. Then what do we do? See, it's as a common man, we okay, other than doing protests, talking about it, said the best contribution we can do is while cutting, take one little more time, few seconds more, instead of separating the piece, make sure that you don't separate out the piece, cut it such that you need not
to. It's still attached.
It's there. There's no separate piece. You just cut it straight, little one line, and take out the milk. The bigger cover goes to recycling, can be handled better. That's it. And people just followed it like anything, it really, and everybody says that's a small thing, but we never realized.
Really, yeah.
And then people started thinking about all these things, about microplastic, about their clothing. And in fact, when I talk about microplastic, every time when we wash our polyester clothing, there is a small microplastic getting into the water. The sewage treatment plants are not able to recognize them. It just passes through the sewage treatment plants. And why it's coming through salt is the entire ocean today is contaminated with plastic, this fine plastic dust. Sometimes it's so scary. But at the same time, I always feel being the most intelligent people, and still we have lot many sensitive people in the society. When we can add microplastic, we know how to remove microplastic from the ocean. And now our youngsters especially are working towards all these things. When I meet so many youngsters, because today our children from the Mid-Day Meal School and also the other children who are interacted with Adamya Chaitanya's works, many children come as volunteers, come for tree planting youngsters. Now many have passed out, they have completed their education. They are showing lot of interest in these areas.
For our youth and the citizens of tomorrow, I think they have to learn now if we have to protect our climate. Very, very important. But then another thing which really interested me, you've got your honorary PhD, okay? And this PhD didn't come just like that. I mean, though it was honorary, it was for some unique work that you saw. You got a biogas plant put into every house. Can you explain that to us?
Yeah. This is somewhere in 2009-10 when there was heavy rains in Karnataka. Like even last year we had, especially in North Karnataka, and many people lost their houses. Adamya Chaitanya as a responsible organization, we wanted to take one village, adopt a village and do our bit. And we adopted a village called Ramtirth in Belgaum district. And we started going there, find out what is required and all that. And we realized there's not even one toilet in the whole village. Even for our volunteers to use it, there was nothing. We were taken aback. In a sense, how do we work there was one big, because I have a big number of women volunteers. And it's very important, very embarrassing. It's very important. And then I always think, yeah, for us it's one day, once in 1 month when we visit, but just imagine those women, and it is really so difficult for them, and how do they live? So we decided, okay, house and all is, it's okay, with our budget, let's build toilet. Then I started going deeper, then we realized every kitchen is based on the firewood. And who bring the firewood? It is again the women go to nearby area, bring the wood, cook in those dark rooms. Literally, now there's literally no house, but take out some space and cook. And that's and all the time of women, and also their energy, time. And look at the, when there's no toilet, absolutely no confidence in them. Then thought, why not come out with a solution with the limited amount what we had. We had only 15 lakh rupees for the whole village. But we came out with an idea wherein they get a good clean fuel, where they need not have to spend money for the fuel. They need not have to cut the trees or go to bring the firewood. It is smoke comes. There's so many issues that everyone knows about it. So we decided that even if they don't have cows, it's okay. We will set up a gober gas. Let them bring cow dung instead of bringing the firewood. Let them collect cow dung from somewhere. So instead of going for a gober gas, we built a combi. Biogas, where the toilet pit is connected to the gober gas pit. And ultimately it's a chemical reaction. And now they get very good fertilizer, they get the gas, then water is also saved because you have to mix cow dung with water and feed. Then most important, they got toilet, they have a good cooking fuel now, very simple clean cooking fuel. We did it for all the 115 houses of that village.
So and all of them have got a toilet plus fuel. Okay, so how was the acceptance of those people?
It was, one is they were not, initial days they didn't understand what it is, where it is connected. We also did not explain them much. But then we realized once they start using it, there may be somebody raising the objection. But at the time of inauguration, when we had to started the first thing, I went to their house. I said, you know, cooking chai, you know, how
so
to
you
cook.
You went and drank it, yeah. Drank it first.
Yeah, yeah, I said, I want to. They were very happy that I have built toilet for them. And it takes 40 days after we start a biogas, gober gas, it takes 40 days to come out, for the gas to come out. Then it is continuous. So for the inauguration, when I went, the gas had come, so we demonstrated how to use. And I said, why don't you make tea? First of all, they said, you drink in our house, wife of a politician from Bangalore, in that small hut. The very fact that we all from Bangalore, women going from Bangalore, sitting in their hut itself was something big for them. They said, you drink in, because, you know, those cars, so many the things are there in that. Yeah, so they said, whether you drink in our house, whether you eat. Said, why not? We are ready to eat, but first you make tea for us. We will drink tea. In that gas, we demonstrated how to use, how to make it on. And I am the first person to drink tea from there. And my friends, of course. they're happy, and they just accepted it.
I think this was a truly deserved PhD. Imagine a person who's done electronics, okay, engineering, and we always think that electronics means something to do with all these computers and laptops and a whole lot of software, and you've gone into some kind of a green environment and pollution free, and then you got into gober gas, etc. But I never would associate, you know, electronic degree, BE, with gober gas now, for example. And I think, and getting a PhD in that, and that is an amazing thing, because these are things that I'm sure my viewers would never have known. They would have thought that Dr. Tejaswini Anand Kumar is wife of a politician. Now, this is something which will be an eye-opener to everybody. Going back again to these children in school, now you saw these children from the 5th standard, 6th standard, 7th standard, and possibly you were also observing that the children's performance was slowly getting better. The dropout rate was coming down, the performance was much better than before, and the pass rate in the SSLC. And I believe, and I have seen also, that the statistics are showing that the government school children are doing remarkably well after the midday meal. So which clearly proves the point that if the nutrition is good and of course the teaching is good, the government school children are no different from the private school children. What is your experience?
Yeah, very true. I have the same number because I, again, like I said, I have like these numbers, tracking those numbers. And before the midday meal, schools where we were working around 30 and odd schools, where the passing percentage used to be literally 28%, 30%. And if they don't pass SSLC, that's it, their education is over. And they don't even get jobs. In fact, my first program is teaching computer for SSLC failed students. If you are SSLC pass, then I said, no, I will not teach. You can find, you will get someplace. But if you are a fail in SSLC, everything is gone. Literally, the life is over. That's the situation today. And of course, this is 25 years back. So our first program is teaching tailoring and also computers for SSLC failed girls. That's how we started Adamya Chetana. So the passing percentage used to be 28, so out of 100 children, only 28 children used to pass. And out of 28, how many used to go to Ford College? And that's a different story. So after midday meal and after little interaction with these schools, if sometimes teachers are not there, the mathematical teacher is on a long leave, then using our influence as wife of a politician, making sure that some other teacher is appointed there, or we ourselves going and teaching or involving volunteers in teaching, all this along with the midday meal brought a big difference. Just attention to children that, okay, you read, if you have some difficulty, you come to us, we are there to teach you. That's enough for these children. That's what I have seen. And they are now, the passing percentage is after 10 to 15 years of midday meal. Every year we look at their marks, we look at the passing percentage of school level. We serve 270 schools in Bangalore. Now it is passing is 95, some schools it's 100% passing.
Excellent.
That's something excellent. Remarkable. And the topper used to be 60-65% earlier, percentage of marks. Now, this time the top 99.4 in our midday meal last. So I don't know, the 3 marks where she lost. It is really something more than 95 now. Last 5-6 years, it is the topper always scores more than 95-96% out of all 270. Some schools still are behind, but still they are 85-90 like that.
Which is excellent. So as a result of this, Tejaswini, you decided that you should sort of, give some recognition to these children who have done so well. So you used to give the child that came first, a certificate and a gift so as to encourage these people. So getting 270 children from, being first in the school, because it doesn't matter what percentage they got, but to give that impetus and say, look, you came first in school. And that was a very noble thought of yours, because that kind of a thing makes them feel that they are worth it. And there's no difference between a private and a government school. Can you tell me about that thing? How did this
work? Event, we always used to do it in our own kitchen area. So we wanted them to see the kitchen. Many children have no opportunity to visit the kitchen. They can't afford bus charge and who will bring them. We tried doing it, but not to all 100% I can't cover. But I thought only at least the toppers of the class are the influencers. So we first show them the kitchen, give them that all importance. Make them, some badge, garland, and they go around the kitchen and they have some questions. We do the interaction, 40 students at a time and all that, and run by volunteers. So they, when they speak to volunteers, including teachers, they are not paid employees. So that also brings in, there are some set of people who care us and who don't worry about the money, but they are spending their valuable time. And this time, because of COVID, we did an online program. And then there's one more thing what I realized is, even the toppers of the class, somebody is from Bihar in one school and he was not traceable. He scored 92%, but we couldn't trace him. It happened for a couple of students because they don't have phone. They don't have access to all this. So he said, you watch on YouTube. Come and join. It was very difficult to do all those things. Then we said, don't worry. Those who can join through wherever, some neighbors or parents phone, you join. It was an online event. And then we traced them, our volunteers reached to their houses and we saw that 10 students come and visit the kitchen, have a nice lunch, food, and then give them the cash award and all these memento and all that. So this has been one event where we enjoy, we also feel that pride that our children have scored so well.
See, these are some of the things that will remain as a legacy. And also for our viewers to know that there's always a joy in giving and seeing a smile on the faces of the less privileged people. It need not be only children, it can be the less privileged. And I've seen that there was so much of activity that is being done by you, and very few people know the kind of activity you have done. Now, just getting on to another note, it has not been an easy life for you being a politician's wife, because at every stage there will be moving from one place to another, and also your time is not your own. You're almost sold to the public, and what you say, what you do, what you don't say, what you wear, and you know, these sort of things are being noticed by public. So how did you feel and how were you able to conduct yourself? Because I never used to see you, you know, tagging on to your husband. Like, I've seen many politicians, you know, where there is an abuse of power by the wives, but I have never seen you do that. You are a person, an icon by yourself, and you've created a niche for yourself, and that is why I've got you on the masterclass. So please explain.
Very, very difficult question that way. One is because, like you said, it's my own life, you know, especially as an engineer while I was working, I used to do things myself independently, and this path was different. But as a wife of a member of parliament, wife of a central cabinet minister, I thought use this influence in doing some things which I wanted people to follow or practice. We talk about like zero garbage, talk about the things what we use day-to-day life things. Many a times we say, why not government do this, make a rule, why not people should do this way. But as a wife of a politician, I always felt that if that same milk cover corner, if any ordinary person would have said this, I don't think it would have been noticed. But being wife of a minister, whatever I do is noticed, it can create an impact. Why not use that? I can go behind him, sit in special aircraft or in good hotel stay. It's all temporary. I'm never fascinated. Both of us were never fascinated by this. Of course, they were there part of this work. But I thought I can really do something which can really influence people if I do it, if I practice. When she can wear a cotton sari and go to a marriage, why is that all these many artificial things are required? Is at least I can influence some women. Many a times these are the way we are, the lifestyle, the way we are going ahead, it's sometimes very scary. In fact, I write article in a Kannada newspaper once in 15 days about these things, you know, day-to-day life, including recently as writing about soap and detergents. It's so scary, you know? Even in the villages where we were working, I've seen everyone uses shampoo, especially those small sachets, and just throw it. There is no plastic recycling in those villages. Everything comes in plastic. They all look at the advertisements and just blindly follow. But who has to tell them what hazardous chemicals are there in these, especially the low-cost soaps and detergents? And nobody is talking about these things. So like that, I take different topics, we discuss, we try to practice it ourselves. Why not again go back using natural soaps, natural detergents? And it should not be only a class of people doing it, but it should reach to masses. And that's where I used his influence. Of course, he also wanted to, he always used to say, if people, he used to always joke, if my party sends me out, I will come and join you in doing all these things. You know, he always used to tell. So I thought I should utilize this time, I should utilize this influence of mine and try to bring in these things which you normally talk in the drawing room on the dining table and just forget about it. So these are the various things about zero carbon, using fossil fuel, planting more and more trees. And especially when I started going, when even Anand Kumar ji was coming for planting the trees, literally on the roadside, you go there, take the thing, all the tools in hand and make pits, basically use your own hands and do it, not just telling people plant tree and then put water and go off. We never did it. So put the tree guard. It's 2 hours. Initially, it was difficult for us, you know. But then it's routine for now. Every Sunday morning, 2 hours you are spending that time. Again, there are numbers behind these. Why we started, and each person needs 700 kg of oxygen for breathing, just for breathing, and a tree gives 100 kg. So one person needs only for breathing 7 trees. And interestingly, when we looked at our urban tree count and the population, the ratio in Bangalore is, the requirement is 1:7, and what it is in Bangalore is 7:1. We have one tree per person, 7 people. And in place like Mumbai, it is one tree for 14 people. And Bangalore being one of the green cities of India, this is the situation. So we thought this message has to go. It is not that how many trees we have really planted. It's very minimal, because for 1 crore population of Bangalore, we needed 7 crores. It is, I don't know whether in
I think
my
if
lifetime,
it becomes a movement, yeah, it is, yeah, possible. So we should not say it's not possible. We should say the whole idea of masterclass is to say that make the impossible possible. And if you lead the way, why not?
And exactly, this Green Sunday program, after like every Sunday we have a board. We say today is 10th, 20th, like that. Today is 257th Green Sunday. Put it on Facebook, Twitter. Yes. Now Raichur has started Green Raichur. Hubli, they have started Green Sunday.
That's
in Bangalore, some places in their area, they have started.
Excellent.
And these are all the replicable model.
Absolutely.
Simple things, common man should be able to do it. It doesn't need very high technology or high-end.
But of course, another thing, Tejaswini, I wanted to say that Anand Kumar has always been a person who is very independent, and he has never actually sort of dictated anything to you. He's always allowed you to be a free thinker and to move forward, and that's why you were able to come up the way. Not that you wouldn't have come up, maybe the task would have been more of an uphill. But he allowed you to grow, and you know, you've really utilized it in a positive way and come up. That's fantastic. But also, since he passed away, it must have been very difficult after years of togetherness, you know, suddenly that void. How were you able to cope with that void?
Yeah, it was really difficult. No, it's because it's been like, especially after I left my IT job and where I used to work for aviation industry. After that, it was like he was working for the nation, for the society, me also getting involved in the similar work. And we used to share a lot of ideas. His is at a national level, mine is at my kitchen level. But still, we used to share all these ideas. And the journey was literally together. It was, and he as a husband, even as a politician, he created a niche for himself. He was a role model, that's what his political colleagues always said, and also as a father, as a husband. He gave space to everyone, even to the children, to his relatives, to me, and also he guided like a teacher. And gave us space, and probably otherwise I would not have done this big work. No, doing big, running a big kitchen, that too for young children, serving food has a lot of challenges. But he stood like a pillar. And when all these things suddenly, like last, especially those 3 months were literally very difficult days. But one thing is, because he was so busy, Many a times he used to be out of Bangalore and I used to do my work myself. Only in the situations of decision making, I always used to call him and he used to, with his experience, he used to give a right thing. And it went on for 30 years. And then I thought, see, I have no other choice, either continue whatever I am doing or sit at home, leave everything and sit at home. Then I thought, yeah, let me assume that he's there in Delhi or he's there somewhere. And now, after living together for 28 years, I can imagine what he would have said to me. He was never directly involved in the work. After some time, he was busy with his work. I used to manage these things myself. So when it comes to decision making, I thought, let me, if I can't guess what he, after living for 28 years, what he would have said in that critical junctures where I have need support more with regard to the decision making. I always, even today, I think he's there. He's not with us today, but he's there, and what he would have said, what he would have guided me in those junctures, I take it, I assume myself that it is he, and give that suggestion to myself and take things for move forward. And now it's 2 years now, November 12, 2018, he passed away. So whatever things I can continue myself, it is not just, it is not fulfilling his dreams. It is not possible and it is very difficult. His journey was different, his roadmap was different. Mine is, he always played that supportive role to me. And whatever roadmap which I have for myself, assuming that he is there, I've continued all those works, and by God's grace, this whole, his friends, my relatives, his relatives and the society has supported all these 2 years. I'm sure now, I'm confident that the society, the people around will support, and it is finally, the dream was doing our bit for the nation and for the society, which of course his presence would have definitely changed the course of our journey, but assuming that he is there, I'm thank God I'm able to continue.
So, Dr. Tejaswini, what is the message that you would like to give our viewers who are watching this show?
Just to summarize, so one is, we have to think globally and act locally, and the small changes in our life, in our day-to-day life, those small things can bring in a big change. I think these two things, I can just share whatever I've tried it practically myself. It could be Green Sunday, it could be how we open a plastic cover, or involving ourselves in the works and changing lifestyle can really bring in a big change and gives us a big satisfaction.
Things that you've shared with Anant Kumar ji, and that's how one goes forward. A positive thinking person will take it the way that you've done, and you must continue the good work that you've been doing, because after all, the public needs you, the citizens need you, and that's what Anant Kumar ji would have wanted out of you. Because see, all of us have a finite life, but at the same time, your legacy will live on. And so thank you very much for coming on my show and giving so much of insight into all the kind of green work that you've been doing, because many viewers would not have known this aspect of you, and I'm very happy that you have and enlightened my viewers. Thank you very much, Dr. Tejaswini Kumar.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Welcome you all to the masterclass by renowned gynecologist Dr. Kamini Rao. I will be engaging in a conversation with her and I'm sure you'll find this conversation very engaging and interesting. Thank you.